This is the Trundle, an Iron Age fort on the South Downs, about 5 miles away to the north. It was probably from here that a people known as the Regni came down into the fertile plain below and established their first tribal capital, now called Chichester. On the chalky downs, they unearthed a stone of considerable importance in the building of Chichester, flint. There for the asking, wherever the soil was turned over. If Chichester wanted stone without the expense of importing from elsewhere, it just had to be flint. There was nothing else. An odd material, isn't it? No other people has made nearly as much use of it as we have. In the southern and eastern counties, in fact, it was for centuries a great standby. Its origin is quite obscure. Geologically, it's a silica, shiny and often almost black inside, as can be seen when it has been fractured. But through contact with chalk, it usually develops a kind of white rind over the entire surface. It's exceedingly hard, virtually indestructible, in fact. The Romans used it freely, and it was they who first gave Chichester its walls. They used flint as a facing material for the modest ramparts of earth which went up first at the end of the second century. But the walls that we see here today are not Roman, neither is this bastion, though it occupies a Roman site. England has 4 towns in which the walls are fairly well preserved, and all 4 have a Roman inheritance. But at York and at Chester, the walled area was somewhat enlarged in the Middle Ages. Here, as at Colchester, it wasn't. The walls and the bastions, though today medieval, follow the line of their Roman predecessors exactly. John Speed's map, engraved in 1611, shows very clearly just how the Roman plan has survived the centuries. Very characteristically, the Romans drove through the town 2 straight streets, one running north-south and the other east-west with a crossing at the center. That's still the plan today. Although the modern town has expanded beyond the Roman walls, within them, the main streets still divide it into 4. And at their intersection is the Market Cross. The ancient streets around the Market Cross are today a shopping precinct, and many of the shops are themselves converted houses dating from the last 2 centuries, which reflect a period more stylish and more leisured than our own. Chichester is a cathedral town, and a cathedral, apart from the spire, is a legacy of the Normans. By Norman standards, this church is in no way spectacular. Money was evidently short. Progress was slow, and the job took nearly 100 years to complete. Nor was the quality of the building very good. Flint, the only local stone, was clearly regarded as too humble for the main structure of a cathedral. So the walls, outside and in, are of limestone. But it's only a facing. There are several kinds of limestone here, and they differ considerably. The first one to be used was Core Abbey stone brought across from the Isle of Wight. It is a hard tertiary limestone which is worn very well. We see it here. It has a most distinctive appearance produced by tiny shell fragments deposited in fresh water. Then in 1186, which was only 2 years after the cathedral had been consecrated, there was a very bad fire. And for the rebuilding, they used quite a different stone brought from Caen across the channel in Normandy. Now, Caen stone, which is this one, is a Jurassic limestone of much finer consistency, and in places, after nearly 800 years, some of the blocks have flaked pretty badly. It's very instructive to to see these two very different stones juxtaposed in this wall on the south side of the nave. Most of these facing blocks are about 6 to 8 inches thick, and of course there's another lot facing inwards, but in between the two there's nothing but a hodgepodge of chalk from the downs and flints and flinty pebbles from the seashore and a lot of mortar. And as usual in the Norman period, the facings are not well bonded with the core. It was the weakness of the infilling which was ultimately responsible for a calamity. In the summer of 1860, it was decided to remove the screen from under the central tower. When this was done, alarming cracks and fissures were revealed in the two piers supporting it. After that, the drama quickly gathered momentum. In January 1861, adjacent walls started bulging. On the 16th of February, an attempt was begun to encase the two worst affected piers in baulks of timber hooped together with iron bolts. 4 nights later, a violent storm blew and the spire rocked and swayed. And by noon on the 21st, it became clear that nothing could save it. 70 men working on the tower were brought down just in time. Some of them, I dare say, from very near where I am standing now. Long ago, I remember meeting an old man who described how, as a boy, he was in a train that day approaching Chichester, when, looking out of the carriage window, the unbelievable happened. The spire suddenly disappeared. It was, in fact, at exactly 1:30 that it descended perpendicularly into the church, and much of the tower came with it. And no one was even injured. The rebuilding was entrusted to George Gilbert Scott, and he did an excellent job. He faced a daunting task, as next day the Times reported.
The spire in its fall sank gently into the centre of the building, like a large ship quietly but rapidly foundering at sea. It fell to the floor with but little noise, forming a mass of near 6,000 tons of ruin in the centre of the church.
The Arundel screen, or pulpitum, the removal of which had precipitated this collapse, was restored to its original position in 1961, just 100 years after the event. Through it can be seen the new reredos installed in 1966. It's a tapestry designed by John Piper and woven at Aubusson in France. The central theme is the Holy Trinity. The outer panels show the four elements, earth, air, fire, and water. And below are the winged emblems of the evangelists, St. Matthew, a man, St. Mark, a lion, St. Luke, an ox, and St. John, an eagle. It makes a gorgeous splash of colour behind the high altar. Too gorgeous for some people, I dare say, but not for me. Far and away the most notable surviving feature of the original church is the pair of reliefs, part of a choir screen or perhaps a reredos, now built into the wall of the south choir aisle. They date from about 1140. In the first scene, Christ, attended by 3 and formerly 4 disciples, is just arriving at the house of Mary and Martha at Bethany. The two women, grief-stricken over the death of their brother, are pleading for his help. Strong and determined, Christ seems engrossed in thought. In the second scene, the miracle has been performed. The atmosphere is now much more dramatic. Only the gravediggers, for whom this was just another job of work, remain unmoved. Lazarus, just risen, seems dazed. Christ, again represented larger than the other figures, is a creation of the most tender humanity. Unforgettable are the faces of Mary and Martha, still overwhelmed with grief. The disappearance of the coloured paste, which is believed to have filled the eyes of all these people, is a positive asset. These are certainly among the most precious Romanesque sculptures in England. In the stone-vaulted chapel of the Bishop's Palace is another of the town's special treasures, a little wall painting known as the Chichester Roundel, dating from 1250. It's said that the silver used for the censers of the two angels has oxidized and turned black, for nothing can be done about this. The rose pink is somewhat patchy, and parts of the blue, lapis lazuli, have faded. But the gold is fairly well preserved. On the handle of the censer, the crown, the child's halo, the head of the sceptre, and the fleur-de-lis powdered over the blue ground. Despite its blemishes, this is one of our loveliest early Gothic wall paintings. The mood is gentle and tender, the composition singularly harmonious. A few yards away, across the passage, is the former kitchen, with rough walls of whitewashed flint and a strictly functional timber roof, which, until early in the present century, had, like other medieval kitchens, a central flue open to the sky. But at St. Mary's Hospital, erected as an almshouse just before 1300, and unlike any other building of its kind in England still lived in, there's a much grander example of medieval carpentry. Here we're back with local materials. Oak. So abundant in this county as to be known in the Middle Ages as the Sussex weed. This vast roof is 42 feet high at the ridge and sweeps down to within 7 feet of the ground. These low walls are built of flint, the material which 20 years earlier the Franciscans had used for their church, or rather the choir of their church, for it seems that the nave was never built. This is a striking fragment and now serves as part of the City Museum. The Market Cross, erected in 1501, the focal point of the town, was built, like much of the cathedral, in carved stone from Normandy. It was a present to the city, and what a present, from the bishop. Unfortunately, its crown was destroyed in the Civil War and replaced in 1746 by this not very happy topknot. The clock is a little earlier. So far, we've been looking at public buildings, all of stone. On the domestic side, the picture is quite different. I doubt whether there was a single house built of stone in Chichester before about 1800. Then flint made quite an impressive reappearance. This stately Regency house in North Street was probably built round about 1820. With its Tuscan Doric porch and its large sash frame windows complete with their glazing bars and its wide eaves cornice, it's very typical of its date. But look at the flints. They're quite different from anything that we have seen so far. Although they're so hard, flints can be split open quite easily if you know how to do it. And this is the process known as napping. And nearly all the flints in this wall have been napped. And also laid in courses with dressings of yellow brick. And very good they look. All the same, with flint, there is an Achilles heel, and that is the mortar. Nodules of flint sometimes assume the weirdest of shapes. Look at this. And if you have a shape like this, of course, you will have to build with it. You must use a great deal of mortar, and it is the mortar which decays first. And when that occurs, well, they're all too liable to fall out. That's what happened here. To mask the area of mortar, and perhaps also to strengthen it, the wall was profusely galleted, which means that little slivers of flint, like this, were pressed into the mortar while it was still wet. The effect produced most extraordinary, but it isn't unique in Chichester. Here we have it again, on another house of the same period. But on this one, in South Street, very few of the flints are napped. What they did here, to ensure regular coursing, was to select, as far as they could, flints of about the same size. In St. John Street, where again there's abundant galloting, they went in for smoother flints. They were probably gathered from some nearby beach. With these, it's much easier to get regular coursing. Coursing was never a problem with brick, another local but this time man-made material. Chichester today is essentially a brick-built town, and it's a joy to talk about it because some of the Georgian brickwork here is a continual delight. Sussex, and indeed the whole of southeastern England, is justly renowned for the quality of its brickwork. This is no doubt partly due to the skill of the local brickmakers in a region where, by 1700, there was already a long tradition of brick manufacture. But it was also due to the good fortune of the southeast in possessing exactly the right clays. Two kinds of clay were needed for the best bricks, the one plastic, the other sandy. And the art was to blend the two together into a smooth dough. But in the kiln, the bricks weren't all burnt equally. Some were burnt more than others, and those with the more heavily burnt ends were darker. And sometimes, according to the chemical composition of the clay, semi-vitrified or glazed, like these. This variation in color and tone is aesthetically very important. This charming little early Georgian house in East Row was old-fashioned for its date in still being built in English bond. That's to say, with a row of stretchers, bricks laid sideways on, alternating with a row of headers, bricks laid end on. But as we can see, the quality of the brickwork is lovely. Its appeal can be still further enhanced when burnt headers are used to make patterns. In the Georgian age, the usual preference was for an all-over checker pattern with red stretchers and grey-blue headers. These headers were so much esteemed that now and again they were used to face an entire front. Against their subdued colour, the bright red rubbed bricks shine out with special brilliance. The quality of the brickwork in Chichester is so good that it comes as something of a surprise to discover how often it's been rendered. Covered, that's to say, with a thin coat of plaster or stucco, artificially coloured. Although this adds a lively note of variety to the city's streets, I feel that brick as good as Chichester's should be left to speak for itself. where there are good bricks, there are usually good tiles too. Attention to detail on houses in Chichester is an endless source of pleasure. Even on quite humble cottages such as these, the door cases are a delight. For bigger houses, they were more ambitious, and often the fanlights are an added embellishment. Handsome cornices, too, like this one, carved on the projecting wing of the John Eads house, which dates from 1696, were very typical of the later Stuart period. This is a lovely house and ought to be the most imposing in the city. What a shame that it's condemned to hide behind two enormous magnolia trees. The idea of cutting them down would shock some people, I'm sure. But it should be done, and preferably tomorrow. 16 years later, and happily free of any such encumbrance, came Palland House, commissioned by a prosperous wine merchant, Henry Peckham. He was evidently determined to build, regardless of expense. Just look at the window heads. Every one has bricks specially gauged, and every key block is provided with a carved emblem, while the base of each one is cut back in delicately recessed curves. Imagine cutting this in brick. Even the parapet hasn't been neglected. Above each window is a sunk panel, the upper edge of which appears to have been gathered like the soft pelmet of a curtain. The wrought-iron overthrow between the gate piers is an exquisite piece of blacksmith's craftsmanship. And behind is a big Corinthian door case. Within, there's a beautiful staircase of carved oak. Nor is this a grand house on a country estate. It was just a merchant's house in a prosperous market town. But by now, ordinary middle-class people were both able and willing to pay for the choicest refinements. This genial, likeable building is the Council House. It was completed in 1733, although the Gothic tracery of the window is later. The principal room on the first floor has recently been redecorated and is rather handsome. Last two centuries, much in the historic main streets of Chichester has remained unchanged. The pace of life may have altered, but the essential character has not. Even the ubiquitous motor car has been held in check, thanks to a specially bold scheme of pedestrianisation. Around the Market Cross, two of the four main streets are now free of traffic, while in the other two it is severely restricted. Where once the motor car and heavy lorries were on the rampage, you can now walk about and shop in peace. Small and compact, Chichester is an almost perfect place in which to live and work. For the future of historic towns of this sort of size, the lessons are clear and obvious. No widening of streets in the older parts, which here means inside the walls. No multi-story car parks. No high-rise buildings to impinge upon the skyline. And the sympathetic use of building materials. No big slabs of exposed concrete, for instance, absolutely none, where stone and brick prevail. The cathedral apart, brick and flint are what give to Chichester its essential character. The right materials in the right place.